Matthew 24 verse 24. For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall shew great signs and wonders, insomuch that, if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. Here I would like to present a study showing that T.B. Joshua of the Synagogue Church of All Nations is indeed one of the many false prophets the Lord Jesus Christ warned us about in these last days. He is another fulfillment of Matthew 24 verse 24. In this presentation, we will look at six topics. T.B. Joshua linked with Samuel Akin Adewole and a heretic blasphemer Sun Myung Moon, the well-known heretic of recent times. On a spiritual level, these men are linked, they're all working for the same master. We will explore that. We will also look at the false Jesus or another Jesus who the scriptures is not talking about, different from what the scriptures are teaching. Is it possible that someone may come and talk about Jesus? When you study further, it's not the Jesus of the Bible. We will be looking at that here. We will be looking at T.B. Joshua's failed prophecies. We'll be looking at his anointing water that he gives to his followers. We'll look at the idea that T.B. Joshua comes to people in their dreams. And then we'll look at the idea that his followers see him like Jesus. Is he really worshipped? Do they really see him as the Messiah? Yes, we will look at that and look at video evidence of people saying that in his own church. Lastly, I'll give a closing commentary. This will be a short summary of the gospel. Professor Willem Johannes Overneel holds a doctorate in biology, philosophy, and theology. He is currently a theology and philosophy professor at several colleges and theological faculties. He is the author of over 100 books. He lives in the Netherlands where he was born. On the Dove Ministries website, they published a statement that he made about T.B. Joshua. Basically, in the statement, he is defending T.B. Joshua, speaking favorably about him. Dove Ministries say, "The following statement about Prophet T.B. Joshua and the Synagogue Church of All Nations, Lagos, Nigeria, has been made by prominent Dutch theologian Professor Willem Overneel." In this same statement, Willem says this: "I may have my question marks on certain things that happened there because I don't understand them. I am a European and not an African. I have question marks on certain things in his sermons," speaking about T.B. Joshua. I just wanted to highlight this first, that some of these folks, even though they say T.B. Joshua is a man of God, they can see that something is off. Something is not quite right. But then they move on to ignore the warning signs, and then they say something like this: "I am a European and not an African." So the obvious question is, does the gospel of Jesus Christ work differently for Europeans and Africans? No, this is a grand fallacy. The scripture says there is no difference between Jews and the Greek. So as far as the gospel of Christ is concerned, there is neither Jew nor Greek. We are all the same. There is no European, there is no African. If we are all in Christ, we are all the same. We know the same gospel. We practice and live the same gospel. Now let's go into the study. In this video, I'd like to share a crucial piece of information that shows that T.B. Joshua, Samuel Akin Adewole, and the well-known heretic of recent times, Reverend Sun Myung Moon, are of the same fold. Now, before I go into this information, let's just look at key scriptures. 2 Corinthians 11 verse 4 says, "For if he that cometh preacheth another Jesus, whom we have not preached." Now this is key to what we are about to study. 2 Timothy 3 verse 13 says, "But evil men and seducers shall work worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived." This is also important. Matthew 7 verse 21 to 23 says, "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, But he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works. And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Matthew 24:24 says, For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that, if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. And Matthew 24:5 says, For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Now these scriptures will be important. Keep them in mind as we go through this study here now. Going right into it, this is Prophet Dr. Samuel Akin Adewole. He was a shepherd at the Celestial Church of Christ in Opopo Igbala Parish, Lagos, Nigeria. It is claimed he used to give very accurate predictions. We are told he had an accountancy degree and economics master's degree from Yorkshire City University in the UK. We are told he also had an honorary Doctor of Divinity degree of Stanton University, Tampa, Florida, in the US. He worked for many years as a banker before finally settling down in the Vineyard of God. Now these I got from the articles and on these web pages. If you go on these URLs, you will find the article that talks more at length about this man. Now it is said that this man, Prophet Dr. Samuel Akin Adewole, around 1995, he received a revelation from Jesus regarding TB Joshua. At around the same time, around 1995, the same year, he received a revelation from Jesus regarding Reverend Sun Myung Moon. Now, the crux of the revelation points out that these three men are spiritual colleagues. They are all working for one master. Now, let's unpack this. Let's start by examining the revelation he had about TB Joshua. We will quote him from the TB Joshua blog. Before I quote him, let me take you to that blog. This is the blog in question, the TB Joshua blog. Here's the article. It says, Incredible, a prophet's prediction about TB Joshua. This article is said to have been published by Streetwise magazine. Here's the man, Prophet Adewole. We will only quote this section. So, this blog is also listed on TB Joshua's official website. This is the Synagogue Church of All Nations, the official website of TB Joshua's church. Here's the blog. You'll see when you click on it, it takes you right into that TB Joshua blog here. But we are interested in this article here. You will see the same article is carried out in Celestial Church of Christ website, the same one. Incredible. Late Prophet Adewole's prediction about TB Joshua. You can come on this website and read the whole article for yourself or on this one. So going back, this is what we are told Prophet Adewole said. He says, I was attending to people in my office one day when three journalists entered. The three of them came from three different media houses. They asked, Prophet Sir, we see and know you to be one of foremost prophets of God in Africa today. Millions of people are looking forward to your comments because you are the only prophet who has never commented on the subject. At this point, before they mentioned what they really wanted, and the man in question, our Lord Jesus Christ, appeared to me from the altar in my office on a golden, very beautiful and mighty chair. He commanded me not to join fake, jealous and envious prophets to say blasphemy against a fellow messenger of God. This in bold writing we are told is what Jesus said to Adewole. It says, The man in the synagogue is mine. He is your spiritual colleague. He is not fake. His power is not mixed. I do as I please. You are all working for my glory on earth. Do never disown or desert him. Truly he is young in age, but my spirit in him is pure and great. His grace is special. Many will fall through him, while others will rise through him also. Advise him always like a son, friend, and colleague, and do not judge him at all, because God is the only judge. I reveal this to you because you fear, adore, and do my wish always. I love you. And he disappeared. Now the same guy, Prophet Adewole, received a revelation regarding Reverend Su Myung Moo. We will quote him from this publication, Unification News. It's a publication from Reverend Su Myung Moon's movement. But before we quote him, let's just look at Reverend Moon briefly, look at his theology and his beliefs. Reverend Moon is the founder of the Unification Movement. He and his wife are called true parents. It is claimed that they are the first couple to have the complete blessing of God and to be able to bring forth children with no original sin. He and his wife are claimed to be the Messiah and true parents of all humanity. It is claimed that he said Jesus asked him to continue the work which he had begun on earth 2,000 years before. Now the blasphemy here is screaming out, you can't miss it. I don't even have to point it out. If you want to read more on this, you can go on this website, unification.org, and read more about Rev and Mrs. Moon. Now, Rev Moon says, the words I speak do not come from theological research or from any books. I speak rather of fundamental principles that I have learned through experience as I overcame all manner of difficulties and communed directly with God and spirit world. So Moon communes with the spirit world. That's first hint of spiritism right there. Moon declared himself the Messiah. I will quote Moon's speeches that he has made through his life. The speeches I'm about to quote of Reverend Moon can be found on this website, unification.net. I will reference them by dates. That's how they are indexed on this website. In a speech he made in August 24, 1992, he says, in early July, I spoke in five cities around Korea at rallies held by Women's Federation for World Peace. There, I declared that my wife and I are the true parents of all humanity. I declare that we are the Savior, the Lord of the Second Advent, the Messiah. He further says, my teachings as the person who has declared for himself the responsibilities of the Messiah. Then he says again, I as the Messiah. Now, according to the scripture, the Messiah is being interpreted the Christ. The Messiah is the Christ. So therefore, Reverend Moon says, effectively, he's saying that he is the Christ. What did Jesus say about that? He said, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. So Reverend Moon here is a strong fulfillment of the scripture here. Now Moon further says, in January 17, 1993, he says, because of the cross, salvation is only spiritual. Jesus brought spiritual salvation, but salvation needs to be done physically with countries on the world level. So the obvious question is, so who is bringing physical salvation? Well, that's Rev Moon, of course. Now that is a heresy. Further, on April 16, 1996, Moon says, the Lord of the Second Advent comes to perfect the foundation of God's providence of restoration left uncompleted by Jesus. He finds the bride that Jesus could not find. Together they become true parents to save all humankind. Now Rev Moon here attacks the very fiber of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Moon has further strange and blasphemous beliefs. On that same speech, April 16, 1996, he says, Mary did not help Jesus with the wedding he desired. She even opposed it. This was the direct reason that Jesus could not receive his bride and could not become the true parent. And this forced him to go the way of the cross. He further says, because of the lack of faith in him, that's Jesus, he could not receive his bride. He could not become the true parent. and he could not accomplish his mission. This is why he promised to return. Now, not only has Moon here attacked the very fiber of the gospel of Jesus Christ, but he further goes on to attack the divinity and the deity of Christ by reducing Christ to a mere mortal man who is driven by worldly and fleshly desires. Now, Moon goes on a step further with his blasphemies by denying the virgin birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. On April 18, 1977, Moon says, "In the genealogy of Jesus, the names of four adulterous women are recorded: Tamar, Ruth, Bathsheba, and Mary. He unfairly labels Ruth as adulteress. But what's most shocking is that he labels Mary as adulteress, in direct contradiction to the scripture. The scripture says, 'A virgin shall be with child and shall bring forth a son.' Matthew 1 verse 23. So Moon effectively is denying the virgin birth, and therefore he is also attacking the divinity and the deity of Jesus Christ once again. Now, unfortunately, Moon's blasphemies don't end there. He goes on further to elaborate his claims here by stating that Zechariah is the biological father of Jesus. On February 7, 1995, Moon says, "Who was the father of Jesus Christ? Zechariah. This followed the same formula of legal wife and legal mistress. The mistress was Mary and the legal wife was Elizabeth. The result of the relationship between Zechariah and Mary was the birth of Jesus Christ." He further says, "Thus Jesus and John the Baptist's sister had the same father but different mothers. They were half brother and sister. They had different mothers. They were both children of Zechariah." Further, on September 8, 1996, Moon says, "The main reason that John the Baptist could not follow Jesus with his whole heart was because John the Baptist knew that Jesus was his half-brother." It is clear here that Moon is preaching another Jesus who is not preached in the scriptures. It is clear that this is a different Jesus who is not preached by the apostles. Yet, despite all of these evil and malicious attacks on the scriptures, despite all these blatant lies from the devil, despite all these blasphemies of the highest order, despite all this deceptive and satanic doctrines that Rev Moon is preaching, he still gets a thorough revelation of endorsement from this respected Nigerian prophet. You will see here the Unification News, January 1998 publication on page 10. It carries the article. It says, "Nigerian prophet links Jesus and Rev Moon." Now we will quote a few sections of this article. The article starts off by introducing this man. It says, "In Nigeria, there is a well-known prophet named Dr. Samuel Akin Adewole, who was blessed in 1995. For the past 3 years, he has been spoken of here as the greatest prophet in the nation, if not in Africa, because he has accurately predicted political and other events and is known for this ability. He has direct access to high places and is a spiritual advisor of high repute. Recently, heaven has revealed much to him, not only about events in Nigeria and Africa, but about true parents and the Family Federation for World Peace and Unification." Now here, this is what we are told Jesus said to Prophet Adewole. It says, "And finally, Jesus told me that Rev Sun Myung Moon is his. He, Jesus Christ, lives in Rev Moon. He, Rev Moon, does nothing on his own but through me, Jesus. I anointed him because I love him, because he loves all mankind and has suffered for me more than anybody else in the world. Therefore, whoever loves him, Rev Moon, loves me, Jesus, and he that rejects him, rejects me. Join hands with him, heartily propagate and disseminate the good news to the nations. I bless you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost." Then Jesus said to me, "Stand and follow me now." and we all flew together to Onicon Stadium with billions of angels and heavenly elders. This is not the Jesus we know through the biblical account. This is indeed another Jesus whom the scripture has not preached, whom the apostles have not preached. This is another spirit. It's another gospel. This is, in fact, these men being deceived, and they continue to deceive also. So this is now a problem, because some today in the Christian community would like us to believe that TB Joshua is a true prophet of God with all his miracles and all of that. That's what they stand on mostly. Now, the problem is miracles alone do not validate any prophet. If they hold that TB Joshua is a true prophet of God, then in the same breath, they would have to embrace Reverend Sun Myung Moon and Prophet Adewole. They are all of the same fold. They are all inspired by one entity. The same entity that inspired Reverend Moon and his teachings and his doctrine is the same entity that inspired Prophet Adewole, and it's the same entity that inspired TB Joshua. So you cannot say TB Joshua is a true prophet and then dismiss Reverend Moon and his heresies. They are of the same fold. They're cut from the same cloth. I'll make you an example. If I said to you, I believe the prophets of the writings of Prophet Daniel or Jeremiah or Ezekiel, but I don't believe the prophets of the writing of Prophet Amos, Micah, Malachi, you would say that's absurd. And of course, that is absurd. I mean, the scripture talks about the law and the prophets. There's this phrase throughout the scripture. No, it's either Moses and the prophets, or it's the law and the prophets. All this refers to all of the Old Testament, all the prophets mentioned in the Old Testament. So if you believe one, then by default, you have to accept the rest. If you reject one, then you have to reject all of it. They are a package. They are inspired by one guy. They are inspired by one God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So the same problem we have here. These three men are inspired by one entity, and it is not the Jesus of the Bible. So if you accept one, that means you accepting all of the fallacious and absurd doctrines that Moon is teaching. So this calls for the children of God to really wake up. And if they've been involved and deceived by TB Joshua, it really is time for them to get out and come back to the Lord, come back to the light, have nothing to do with any of these ministries. The Apostle Paul, in 2 Corinthians 11 verse 4, he says something that we really need to pay attention to. He says, "For if he that cometh preacheth another Jesus, whom we have not preached." Now the question is it possible that someone may come and talk about Jesus, and then you find that it's not the Jesus of the Bible? Well, the answer is simply yes. We must also remember the warning that Jesus gave us, says, "For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many." What we see these days is that even entities from the spirit realm claim to be Jesus. Many of them have appeared to a lot of people, and they claim to be Jesus Christ. Let's talk about this. There's a spiritual entity out there going by the name Sananda. This is the photo of him. We are told it was taken in 1961. It says, "Sananda appeared in visible, tangible form and permitted this photograph to be taken." He says, "I am that I am. I am Esu, Jesus, Sananda, Emmanuel, the sacred circle of infinity." Already using God's title there, "I am that I am," to appear as if he's the Jesus of the Bible. Let's further look at this guy. He says, "I am Sananda of the sacred circle of infinity, for I am come again as one with the Most High Living God, / Atten, / Father. Now, does this sound like anything you've ever read in the Bible? Not even close. He further says, I am Esu, Jesus, Emmanuel, Sananda, of the Christed Sacred Circle of Infinity, and one with the Father. This is not the Jesus of the Bible that we know. Now look how crafty he is. He says, I said, let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe in the creation, and also in me. What's interesting is that Jesus in John 14 verse 1, he never said, believe in the creation. He simply said, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. So this is not the Jesus that the Bible talks about. And then there's this woman. Her name is Doreen. Now Doreen claims that Jesus Christ told her the truth about Sananda. She says Jesus told her that Sananda is in fact fake. Now let's look at Doreen's claims. She says her spirit name is Yama-El. Now she says, Jesus told me in no uncertain terms that he has not now or ever used the name Sananda. And he said, there are beings who go by that name, but I am not one of them. He then proceeded to tell me that contrary to what is being channeled, his real name is not Sananda. And any entity who claims that he, Sananda, is Jesus Christ, is lying and cannot be trusted. If they lie about who they are, then how can one trust anything else they have to say? He said point blankly. Now Doreen goes on to quote Kim Michaels. We will get to Kim Michaels shortly. But this is what she quotes from Kim Michaels. She says, he says, among my colleagues of the ascended host, I am known as Jesus, Jesus Christ, and the ascended master Jesus Christ. These are the only names that I have used after my ascension, and these are the only names that I plan to use. Now let's point out line number one. Among my colleagues of the ascended host. That's line number one. Line number two. These are the only names that I have used after my ascension. Now let's set the record straight. Jesus is God, and God has no colleagues. You will see this many times, that God said, beside me there is no savior, a just God and a savior. There is none beside me. Is there a God beside me? I know not any. Beside me there is no God, for there is no savior beside me. There is none beside me. There is none else. I mean, God repeatedly here makes it clear that he is the only one. He has no colleagues. He has no equals. He is almighty in the class of his own. And then further, Jesus is also known as the Lamb. You'll see this many times in the book of Revelation. The 12 apostles of the Lamb, the blood of the Lamb, the Lamb's book of life, the Lamb's wife. This is referring to Jesus. And Jesus also repeatedly called himself Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, the first and the last. And Jesus also is known as the Lion of the tribe of Judah. One of the 24 elders is telling John there in Revelation 5 verse 5 that the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, hath prevailed to open the book. Now the elder here is talking about Jesus. Therefore, this Jesus that they speak of here is not the Jesus of the Bible. This we can dismiss. And then there's Kim Michaels. In his website, he calls it askrealjesus.com. He speaks about Jesus and, you know, it's all about Jesus there. But then when you study further the material, you can see that it's not the Jesus of the Bible. He says, the idea of the website was that people could ask Jesus a direct question and would then get, get the answer from Jesus through direct revelation. I would also receive more direct messages called dictations from Jesus, and gradually from many other ascended masters. Now, why is he getting messages from other masters? Who are the other ascended masters? Because Jesus said, only through him will we get to the Father. So this is another clue that this man is not talking to Jesus. He's talking to another lying spirit who is claiming to be Jesus. Now you will see further proof when he says, Jesus was and is an example to follow. And it is a tragedy that mainstream Christianity has turned him into an idol to worship. Now folks, I just want to prove it to you. I'm not making this up. Here is his website. Now here's the portion. He says, Jesus was and is an example to follow. And it is a tragedy that mainstream Christianity has turned him into an idol to worship. This is not Jesus of the Bible that we know. If you read the Bible, you realize that Jesus is in fact worshipped. In Hebrews 1 verse 6, God said, let all the angels of God worship him. And many instances as well, you see Jesus is worshipped. So Jesus being worshipped, it's not something that is starting now with mainstream Christianity. Jesus was worshipped in biblical times, and he will continue to be worshipped through eternity. Therefore, Kim Michaels and Doreen are not talking about Jesus of the Bible. This is in fact another Jesus. They are giving heed to seducing spirits. They are listening to lying spirits. And then you get to Rev Moon. Now listen to this and compare it if it sounds like the gospel as it is told in the Bible. It says here, after personally accepting Jesus' call, the young man set out to discover its very meaning. If Jesus called him to complete his mission, it meant that Jesus' mission was incomplete. Was not salvation through the cross all that man needs? What was it that Jesus had left undone on earth? If sin is not completely solved, then what is the actual root of sin? On March 16, 1960, Reverend Moon was blessed in holy marriage to Hak Jah Han. This marked the beginning of the restoration of humankind back into God's lineage. Now let's point out, the scripture says differently. The scripture says Jesus had offered one sacrifice for sins forever. And Jesus had by himself purged our sins. So he doesn't need Rev Moon to come and finish off whatever Rev Moon says it's not finished. Because Jesus also said himself that it is finished. So there is nothing to come and complete. Jesus finished the work. So this is a false Jesus that Moon is talking about. It is a false gospel that is not told in the scriptures. Now, Paul, the Apostle Paul warned us here. Says, for he that cometh preacheth another Jesus whom we have not preached. Indeed, this is what happening. These people are talking about another Jesus whom the scriptures have not preached. They have another spirit. They are preaching another gospel which we have not accepted. The reason is because they are giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. They are listening to lying spirits. And for this reason, they are being deceived. And in turn, they continue to deceive. They are deceiving and they are being deceived as well. Now, that is why in the end, Jesus says, will say to them, I never knew you. Notice he doesn't say, I knew you and you departed from me. No, he never knew them, period. That means not even at one point did he know them or were they talking to him. So that means all this communication that they are having is not with Jesus. It is with these seducing spirits, with these lying spirits, which I personally believe it's the fallen angels or the devil himself. Now, I would make the point again that these three men are not talking about the Jesus of the Bible. This is, in fact, another Jesus who is not preached in the scriptures. Now, after considering all of these things, It is for this reason that I would caution anyone from praying in the name of the God of TB Joshua, because you don't know which God he's praying to. Now, according to all the evidence that is available here in front of us, it is clear that he is not serving a Jesus of the Bible. This is not the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob that these men are serving. So rather pray to the God of the Bible. Rather serve Jesus who is revealed in the Bible. Salvation is personal. Work out your own salvation. Do not depend on the God of TB Joshua.
He tells people, when people come there with problems, we cancel them, especially the HIV, serious sicknesses. They should not take drugs. They should keep blessing water in the name of the God of TB Joshua.
God of my prophet TB Joshua is good. God of TB Joshua is God that answered by fire.
I was praying, God of TB Joshua, deliver us.
We begin to pray and say, God of prophet TB Joshua,
tell us how you and your daughter came together and pray with the anointing water.
We administered it and we said, God of prophet TB Joshua.
So some said, oh, God of prophet TB Joshua, today we have believed you.
Again, I would make that point. Do not depend on any man's God. Work out your own salvation. Salvation is personal. Depend on the God who is revealed in the Bible. Pray to the God who is revealed in the Bible. Pray to Jesus who is revealed in the Bible, not anyone else's God. When it comes to prophecy, TB Joshua does not have a good record. He has been known to prophesy even about football games. It is there on his website. It says, Prophet TB Joshua prophesied concerning AFCON qualifying match between Nigeria and Guinea. God was showing me the game between Nigeria and Guinea next week. There is no fear of God here. This has nothing to do with the gospel of Jesus. In fact, this will encourage more gambling instead of repentance. People who bet on football results will use these so-called prophecies to place heavy bets. This is fortune telling. This is divination, not Christianity. God gave us a way to test the prophet, and TB Joshua fails this test in a big way. The scripture says, when a prophet speaketh in the name of the Lord, if the thing follow not, nor come to pass, that is the thing which the Lord hath not spoken, but the prophet hath spoken it presumptuously. Thou shalt not be afraid of him. Now, TB Joshua has a lot of failed prophecies. Let's just look at a few. Normally, when there is a disaster somewhere, TB Joshua releases a video claiming that he prophesied about it. When news broke that Malaysian airliner flight MH370 was missing, TB Joshua, as usual, released a video claiming he prophesied about it. Let's watch that video first before we analyze.
God is still saying something. On Sunday, the 28th of July 2013, Prophet TB Joshua gave a prophetic message concerning an Asian nation, warning them of an incident involving a large aircraft carrying over 200 people developing a fault soon after takeoff. He subsequently prayed for the nation. These were his words.
In Jesus Christ's name,
amen.
We have to pray. This is Asia country. I will not mention any country, but God show me the country. I'm seeing a very big balloon. And what is the cause of this? Just about to take off, and the first started. It means they can discover it at the tarmac, but because impatient. If God give me the grace, I will send a letter to the embassy of the country. Check your airline in your country. But it's going to be huge. Almost 200 people inside. What happened here is the fault of impatient. Because there are many things they need to look into before they take off, but they are unable. What is the cost? 200 people inside the plane. But this is Asia country. So we are going to pray for them, and I see what I can do to send a letter to the embassy and let them know that any plane in their tarmac, they should make sure before it moves. Take a cognizant, take note, so that they can avoid this. In Jesus Christ's name.
Amen.
Welcome back. Turning once again to our breaking news, a Malaysia Airlines flight carrying nearly 240 people has been missing for nearly 9 hours now. Flight MH370 left Kuala Lumpur around 2:40 in the morning on its way to Beijing. It disappeared from radar about 2 hours later. The CEO of Malaysia Airlines just wrapped up a news conference. He said he doesn't know where the plane is and said there were at least 14 nationalities represented among the passengers on board. The airline is now notifying next of kin.
So watching this video, it looks like his prophecy came to pass. But the truth is, the video was edited. He took out important details that do not match the event. In the original video, he said, the crash will happen few meters from the airport. The problem will be known. Now let's watch the original video to back this up.
Now I'm seeing this, I don't know whether it's weather. This is purely weather. We have to pray. This is Asia country. God showed me the country, but if I mention the country now, will anybody enter the plane there again? The airline there, I will be in trouble. They say this man have grounded our airline because he mentioned our country. I will not mention any country, but God showed me the country. I'm seeing a very big balloon. And what is the cause of this? Just about to kick off. And the first started, and just a few meters to the airport where they took off, the crash happened. It means they can discover it at the tarmac, but because impatient, I will personally, when I get to home, if God give me the grace, I will send a letter to the embassy of the country. Check your airline in your country. But it's going to be huge, almost 200 people inside. Just from the tarmac, the takeoff. Just few, the incident happened. It means what happened here is the fault of impatience, because there are many things they need to look into before they take off, but they are unable. So it's not anything that they say they don't know the call, no, because it's... Yes. What is the cost? 200 people inside the plane. But this is Asia country. This is Asia country. So we are going to pray for them. And when I leave the service, see what I can do to send a letter to the embassy and let them know that this is what any airline, any plane in their tarmac, they should make sure before it moves. Take a cognizant, take note, so that they can avoid this.
There. Says the crash will happen not far from the airport, few meters from the airport. And then the problem will be known. But the reality is, the plane was never found. And the problem is not known. There is a 60-minute, the whole 1 hour, documentary that discusses the disappearance of flight MH370. You can find it on this URL here. This is a failed prophecy by TB Joshua. The crash didn't happen few meters from the airport. It is not known what happened. to the airplane. Moving on, in another claimed prophecy, TB Joshua was very dishonest and deceptive here. In 2012, on June 24, he gave a prophecy that he sees the flood in an Asian country. Now, in January 2013, 7 months after he gave the prophecy, there was a flood in Indonesia, and he released this video to claim that he predicted this disaster. And then about 10-11 months after this one, in November 2013, there was a typhoon in the Philippines. He released the same video claiming that he predicted this disaster. We're going to watch these two videos. Let us start with the one, the flood in Indonesia.
On June 24th, 2012, during a Synagogue Church of All Nations live Sunday service, Prophet Chibi Joshua delivered a prophetic message regarding a serious flood that would carry property and people, which he saw about to happen in an Asian country starting with the letters IN. He called on viewers to be prepared and to pray for God's mercy and favor. These were his words.
There will be very, very serious rain. I'm seeing a big rain. This will happen in the Asia country. I want to trace the country so God will guide them. I'm seeing great news. I'm seeing a very big flood, and it will carry a lot of houses, property, human beings. The rain is warming up. It's coming from the sea. It's not just rain, but it is a spirit that comes from the sea. It will disturb this city, and it will carry property and a human being. It's a big time situation. I'm seeing a country, IN, fast pray as the spirit direct. Pray for the nation. Be very close now, very close. I will not want to wait till next Sunday before coming out on Emmanuel TV and tell the world this is what I'm saying, so that people can be prepared. If there's nothing they can do about it, people there should be ready to carry the necessary thing out of their house. You know what happened in Japan some times ago. So we are praying for God's mercy and God's favor.
In confirmation of Prophet TB Joshua's prophetic revelation, on January 16, 2013, a very serious flood occurred in the Asian country Indonesia, in the capital city Jakarta. The flood came from the sea and carried people and property, just as the prophet had prophesied. Let us watch the report.
Anda kembali menyaksikan breaking news, pemirsa. Kami akan mengajak Anda untuk melihat bagaimana situasi terkini.
About a quarter of a million people have been hit by flooding in the Indonesian capital, Jakarta. The number rose dramatically yesterday after floods subsided slightly and authorities could measure the impact. So far, a dozen people have died, including a baby girl and a small boy, and a number of people are missing. From East Jakarta, Indonesia correspondent George Roberts reports.
This is Kalibata in East Jakarta, one of the hardest hit suburbs in this disaster.
Now, let us watch the Typhoon Haiyan Philippines. The Typhoon Haiyan in the Philippines, the prophecy video.
God is still saying something. Prophecy, prophecy, prophecy. When God's servant speaks forth, the wise listen. Deuteronomy 18, verse 22. God is still saying something.
During the Synagogue Church of All Nations live Sunday service, Prophet TB Joshua prophesied that a very heavy flood was going to occur in an Asian country. He said that residents there should be ready to carry their property as the rain was already warming up. These were his words.
I'm seeing a very big, heavy flood. I know the CNN will give the event a new name when it happens. There will be name given for it because it's a big time situation. There will be very, very serious rain. I'm seeing a big rain. This will happen in the Asia country.
and it will carry a lot of houses, property, human being. The rain is warming up. It's not just rain, but it is a spirit that comes from the sea, and it will carry property and a human being. Be very close now, very close, so that people can be prepared. People there should be ready to carry the necessary thing out of their house when it is started. So we are praying for God's mercy and God's favor. God loves us. Pray for the nation, this nation that will face this storm that will take over part of the city, so the Lord should rescue this country.
In confirmation of the prophetic message, in November 2013, Typhoon Haiyan crashed into the Asian nation, the Philippines, destroying houses, property, and human beings. Let us watch the report.
This is CNN Breaking News.
And welcome to CNN Newsroom. I'm Natalie Allen. Our top story, of course, is the storm that wrecked the Philippines. People there are struggling in the aftermath of Typhoon Haiyan, possibly the strongest storm to make landfall in recorded history. These are pictures from Tacloban City, which is believed to be one of the worst hit areas.
There you go. Now the question is, which disaster actually did this man predict? Can you see that this is very confusing now? Now let's analyze. In TB Joshua and Emmanuel TV's own words, we are told this will happen in an Asian country. I want to trace the country. It will disturb this city. I am seeing a country. I am. Pray for the nation, this nation that will face the storm that will take part of the city. So the Lord should rescue this country, an Asian country, starting with the letters IN. In confirmation, a very serious flood occurred in Asian country, Indonesia. Now this is very, very, very clear that it is one event in one country. So why does TB Joshua recycle the same prophecy video to claim that he predicted the one disaster in the Philippines as well? And you see that this is dishonest, deceptive, and it's distasteful. TB Joshua here is more concerned about building his reputation, even if it means lying about prophecy to his audience. And by the way, the flood in Indonesia, there's a detail he got wrong also. He said, I know CNN will give the event a new name when it happens. There will be a name given to it, because it is a big time situation. You know, when there's a disaster like Hurricane Katrina, it's given that name, Hurricane Katrina, or now in this instance with the Philippines, it's Typhoon Haiyan. But as far as we know, the Indonesia flood was never given a name. So that suggests that TB Joshua got this one wrong also. It's a failed prophecy here as well by TB Joshua. Moving on to another one. In Nigeria, there is a group of about 200 schoolgirls that were kidnapped by the terrorist group Boko Haram. TB Joshua said the girls would be released immediately. The girls were never released, unfortunately. Now let's watch the video. The following video I got from Joshua Dibanka YouTube channel. Let's watch.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Today we shall look at the marks of a genuine pastor, prophet, evangelist, servant of God. Let's quickly look at the book of Deuteronomy 18. Take a look at verse 21-22. Hallelujah. If you say in your heart, how shall we know the way which the Lord has spoken? That is,
Is it TB Joshua that is speaking, or is speaking the words of God? Verse 22. When a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord, take note of that. When a pastor speaks in the name of the Lord, verse 22. When evangelists speak in the name of the Lord, when a servant of God, born again, a Christian, speak in the name of the Lord, if the thing does not happen or come to pass, that is the thing which the Lord has not spoken. A genuine servant will speak in the name of the Lord accurately. Unless I'm not called by God. I place my career and my calling on the online, that these 200 and plus children, school children, guess they kidnapped, they have to release immediately. Yeah. Immediately.
3 months later, more than 200 girls still remain in captivity. But the Bring Back Our Girls campaign is still hopeful that the girls would be rescued and returned back home safely. The girls were abducted from their boarding school in the northeastern town of Chibok in Borno State on April 14th.
There you go. Another failed prophecy. Let's look at one more. This is Cristina Fernandez de Kirchner, the president of Argentina. TB Joshua gave a prophecy that she must not do an operation or else she won't survive. But she went for an operation and she survived, proving TB Joshua to be false once again. Now let us watch that video. The same also I got from Joshua Debunker YouTube channel. Let's watch the video.
On Sunday, April 15th, 2012. During the live second service at the Synagogue Church of All Nations, Prophet TB Joshua spoke further about the prophetic message, stating that if Argentina's leader underwent an operation, they would not survive. But if they did not do the operation, they would revive after a coma. These were his words.
Once again, I was talking about Argentina issue. I'm seeing somebody being rushed to the hospital. They should not attempt the operation. If operation is not carried out, the leader will succeed. Nothing will happen. He will go into coma, but he will revive her. Satan is looking for a time they will just operate. I'm talking to Argentina nation. This is a leader. Who is that leader? They trying to rush to the hospital, but operation, that is dead. But without operation, they should be bold and believe. We go into coma, they say it's finished, it's only operation, they should not do operation. So this is it. This is a warning. But I want to get the date and time and when. Argentina. This is a leader. Is it a leader, a head? Who which head? Who is that leader there? If they attempt the operation, that is it. But if there is no operation, they just give minor treatment. We'll revive and we'll come back.
Argentine President Cristina Fernandez de Kirchner has been discharged from hospital after successful surgery to remove a blood clot from her brain. Doctors have advised the 60-year-old leader to have strict rest for 30 days, which means no campaigning before congressional elections on October the 27th.
There. Now, according to the words of the Lord, if a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord and that thing doesn't happen, doesn't come to pass, then that prophet didn't speak in the name of the Lord. The Lord did not say that thing. So we should not be afraid of that prophet. So all these threats and intimidation they may put out on Emmanuel TV or wherever, they say touch not my anointed one, or the wrath of God will come upon you for speaking about the man of God, all of that is a heresy. He has spoken prophecies in the name of the Lord and they did not happen. So we should not be afraid of TB Joshua. He is not to be feared. If you want to read more about TB Joshua's prophecies and the tricks and how he see how he manipulates the videos, you may want to come look at this TB Joshua watch blog and come to this page of prophecy. They have covered more prophecies about TB Joshua. They've actually done a good job of exposing the tricks that TB Joshua uses to deceive us into believing that he really prophesy about these events, when in reality he doesn't actually prophesy. Now TB Joshua gives his followers anointing water and anointing stickers. The belief around the sticker is this: if you stick it on your house will be protected. If you stick it on your car will be protected. If you are sick, you can get healed as well if you stick it on your body. This is not different from the Shembe card. I mean, with congregants possessing a picture of their leader for protection. The focus here is no longer on Jesus, but it's on TB Joshua. You can see here with his signature here on the sticker. This is idolatry. Exactly what the Bible warns us about. This is idolatry, idolizing the man. As Christians, we should glorify Jesus Christ. Rather than putting stickers of a man on your house or on your car, we should rather, I would recommend to rather put stickers that glorify Jesus. You know, stickers that preach Jesus, stickers that uplift Jesus for the wonderful Savior that he is. Now, if you have stickers like any of these on your house or on your car, you are actually preaching Jesus, which he said we should do, by the way. But if you have a sticker like this, unfortunately, you are simply preaching TB Joshua. Now, which for a Christian, this is not right. This is not Christianity at all. Now look at the label on the anointing water bottle here. It says, for good health and breakthrough in all areas of your life and for the salvation of your soul. Now this is prosperity gospel. It's about health and wealth. But what's most shocking is that it goes a step further here by saying it's for the salvation of your soul. This is unbiblical. Salvation is not found in some bottle of water from a certain prophet. We must preach the gospel and people must believe and accept it. That's how you get salvation. Jesus said, preach the gospel, and he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Now, with the new anointing water, he labeled it the blood of Jesus. The purpose is still the same: for health, wealth, and salvation. Now in his website, TB Joshua justifies this like this. He says, God used the medium of Paul's handkerchiefs and apron to heal the sick. God used the medium of Moses' staff to split the Red Sea. God used the voice of his servants, Peter and John, to raise a crippled man. God used the medium of Dirty River to heal Naaman. God expressed himself through the medium of the sound of the time of Pentecost. God used David's catapult to defeat the giant Goliath. Jesus used mud and saliva to heal the blind man. God used the medium of Peter's shadow to heal the sick. Now let's put it all into context here. The difference from his anointing water and the examples he is quoting here. For example, Paul's handkerchief. This Paul's handkerchiefs and apron did not become a continuous ministry. Now what that means is that Paul didn't start a mass production of anointed handkerchiefs and anointed aprons for health, wealth, and salvation. Because if he did something like that, that would move the focus away from Jesus. people would now want to get Paul's anointed handkerchiefs or Paul's anointed aprons to solve their problems without even hearing or accepting the gospel of Jesus, which is unfortunately what is happening with TB Joshua's anointing water. The focus is now on this anointing water. I will show you a proof. I will show you an example of this. Just want you to listen to this guy. Just listen how he praises the anointing water.
I want to tell you that there is power, great power. When I say power, power past power. Great power in this anointing water. Whatever problem you are having on this earth, if only you can believe and have the faith, anointing water will cure you. Praise the Lord.
I know full well that this guy was corrected for saying this, and they usually say that, no, Jesus is the healer. But that is exactly my point. Focus is moving away from Christ to this anointing water that they always must try to correct these guys. I mean, what do they expect? The system at SCOAN itself confuses this issue further. The system is set up in such a way that people will ultimately give praises to this anointing water. I just want you to listen to these program directors. Just listen to how they phrase their question around the anointing water. What you are about to hear is taken from just one Sunday service. Let's listen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And finally, madam, what is your advice to people around the world about this new anointing water that God Almighty used to set you free?
Tell us what the new anointing water has done in your life. We want you to educate the people. We want you, what can you say about this new anointing water?
Madam, what is your advice to people who are watching you right now concerning the power of God in this anointing water? Okay. What can you say? What can you say concerning this new anointing water?
Well, we just want to ask, what can you say concerning this anointing water?
And finally, sir, what do you want to advise people around the world about this precious gift that you're holding right now?
What can you now say about the anointing water the brother is testifying about? Okay, what do you have to say about the anointing water? Sir, let's hear from the first brother. What do you have to say about this anointing water?
And finally, what can you say about the anointing water?
Madam, can you give us advice? What can you tell the viewers all over the world that were struggling, that don't have a job, that are going through poverty? What can you advise them about the power of this anointing water?
What can you see about the anointing water?
Can you see the confusion? They want you to say something positive about the anointing water. When you do, then they try to satisfy the critics to say, no, Jesus is the healer, not the water. This proves that this system is not working for the body of Christ, the church. That's why a true Bible-based New Testament church does not practice things like this. That's why the Apostle Paul didn't mass produce his anointing handkerchiefs and anointed aprons, because it will lead to people praising the stuff. So this anointing water and the system at SCOAN itself leads to people praising the stuff, exactly like these guys.
Wherever you are, whatever situation you find yourself, believe that there is power in this anointing water. Praise God.
I want you to come and collect this anointing water. It will change your life to a good, it will turn around your situation.
Amen.
My father in the Lord do say, because of this anointing water, he said, anywhere we take this anointing water to, whatever that is hidden that we cannot see, if this anointing water enter into that house, it will be exposed. God will expose everything.
I want to add that in a very critical time, the anointing water can part a river for people to walk on dry land and cross.
Another point to consider. When this current anointing water was released, this current version, when it was released, people flocked to the venue and there was a stampede. 4 people were killed and many others were injured. Like this woman with a broken leg here. She's one of the victims of that stampede. This incident happened in 2013 on May 19. It happened in a scone branch in Ghana at Spintex Road in Accra. Now, if this anointing water was supposed to bring health and wealth and salvation, why do people get killed and injured on the day when it is released, on the day when they are given this anointing water so that their health can be cleansed, their finances and all of that can be cleansed? Then why is it at that moment when they get killed and injured? The focus is just too much on this anointing water, that people literally trampled on each other just to get their hands on this anointing water. Here are the fruits of this anointing water: 4 people killed and many others injured. This anointing water is not blessed by the Lord. Now, another thing that I've observed about this anointing water, that TB Joshua contradicts himself about this. He first explains the vision that he had, that he saw the blood of Jesus dripping into the pool and the water in the pool was becoming pure and pure. And then later on, he says, actually, the water has nothing. Now, first, let's listen to the video where he's explaining the vision about the blood of Jesus dropping into the pool.
I saw the blood of Jesus, and God revealed to me the hands of Jesus, was the blood was coming out of it. And this blood, as it coming out, the water, it was dropping inside the water, and immediately it dropped inside the water, it formed water. The blood, you were expecting the blood, when it dropped inside the water, it will change the color of the water. But this one was not changing the color of the water. The red blood was dropped inside the pool, and this pool was, as the blood dropped, the pool was clean. The pool was become pure. I keep asking God, why? This is blood. And when the blood dropped inside the water should change color. But the blood was just gushing out. And Jesus, the voice said to me, this pool is the pool he wants to give me, to give to the whole world. And he now gave me revelation about the blood of Jesus. What it is, what is the meaning, more. We know much about it, but more deeper revelation about the blood. So what is the meaning? The Bible, this revelation told me, say, as you take this anointing water, it cleans your business. It cleans your it purifies you. It cleans your career. You know, when the day say a career is dirty, we begin to complain. The career will be cleansed, the destiny will be cleansed, your marriage life will be cleansed, your finances will be cleansed, your business will be cleansed, your health will be cleansed. That is it. And the Lord was saying, this will clean the business, clean the finances, clean the career, clean the body, your health, and clean your marriage. So on those days, as you minister it, you begin to see yourself, refocus, readdress, your focus will change, you have a new direction.
Okay, let's summarize this. So he saw the blood of Jesus dripping into the pool, and each time the water was becoming pure and pure. It wasn't becoming red, the water was becoming pure and pure. I mean, it's clean and clean and cleaner. Now, he was told in the vision that this blood will cleanse your business, will cleanse the finances, will cleanse your career, will cleanse your body, your health, and will cleanse your marriage. Now, after this anointing water was released later on another day, he then says the water has nothing, and God actually said he must package empty bottles. Let's listen to that video.
In fact, let me tell you something. It was empty bottle that the Lord said I should package. It was what? Empty bottle. After everything, the Lord said, just put the empty bottle there. And just breathe, breathe,
inside the bottle and cover it, just empty. And I say, if I give empty bottle to these people, I don't know what will happen. Empty bottle. Give an empty bottle to my people. How will I defend myself? I say it will be an opportunity for a criminal to put something inside and send it to people. So God said, okay. So the water you see inside, like I have said, has nothing. But what is working, miracle, signs and wonder? It's not that water. It is your faith to turn it and spread it. Simple.
Okay. Now he says, the water has nothing. So it doesn't have the blood of Jesus. It has nothing. I mean, what about the vision that he had about the blood dripping inside the water and the water was becoming pure and pure? That vision, where does it fit in into what he has just said about empty bottles commandment? Now let's put this in perspective here. According to TB Joshua, this is what happened. God says to him, package empty bottles, just breathe into them and cover, just empty. And then he argues against it. He says, no, if I give empty bottles to these people, I don't know what will happen. You know, give empty bottles to my people, how will I defend myself? It will be an opportunity for criminals to put something inside. Okay, after this, God says, okay, that's fine. You can put the water, and then we don't know where the vision fits in there. And then it says, call it the blood of Jesus. You know, you would think that the blood of Jesus is sacred and holy and nothing to joke about. But here it is used as an alternative because the empty bottle scenario is not a good idea, as TB Joshua points out to God. Now, as a Christian, this upsets me because the blood of Jesus was shed as a sacrifice to God the Father so that our sins can be forgiven. It was not shared to be a magic potion that will make you rich. God does not need TB Joshua to help him decide when to use the blood of Jesus. And for TB Joshua saying these things about the empty bottles, it is making a mockery of God. I mean, you can just hear the congregation laughing at the idea of empty bottles. I mean, this is just one of the reasons I don't believe TB Joshua is getting these visions from the God of the Bible. One of the very disturbing things about TB Joshua is the idea that he can appear to people in their dreams. For me as a Christian, this raises alarm bells, and I think anyone who is a Christian who thinks TB Joshua is a prophet of God should be worried about this. Benny Rothman visited TB Joshua's church in Nigeria in 2000 in August. He speaks favorably about his experience in TB Joshua's church. He is convinced that TB Joshua is a true prophet of God. Here is his full report here. Here he tells of his experience and his impression about TB Joshua. On this page, he published an interview of TB Joshua, which he says he took from this book. Pastor W.F. Kumui and Prophet TB Joshua are both messengers of God, written by Isaac Akbaje and Abiye Kalu. In this interview, TB Joshua talks about his unique divine personality. Here is the portion. He says, The divine person in me can do a million things simultaneously. I can appear to thousands of people in their dreams in any part of the world to set them free of their sicknesses, problems, and afflictions. This is not Christianity, this. Okay, immediately when you hear something like this, red flags should be going up and alarm bells should be ringing. This is Bill Subritsky of Dove Ministries in New Zealand. He has also visited TB Joshua's church in Nigeria. He also speaks favorably about TB Joshua. He says, after 9 days at the synagogue, Church of All Nations, we concluded that TB Joshua is indeed a man of God, and these are the works of God. Now, in this article, Bill defends TB Joshua, and he also asked him about this thing that he appears to people in their dreams, and TB Joshua denied it. Here is that portion. It says, it has been alleged that Prophet Joshua says the divine person within him can appear to thousands simultaneously, even coming to them in their dreams. Is this correct? Joshua responds as follows. There is nothing like that. Our Lord Jesus is omnipresent, everywhere present. His spirit is omnipresent. Where shall I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? Psalms 139:7. This should not be misinterpreted against me. I assume Bill Subritsky will go with what TB Joshua has told him, which in principle there's nothing wrong with that. But according to the testimonies of people in TB Joshua's own church, this seems to be happening. So that means TB Joshua has just lied here to Bill Subritsky. Now we will look at these testimonies. Let's start with this one. On the TB Joshua blog, the article titled Hindrance to Prayer, you get to this article and then there is a testimony here. It says, Resurrected, Emmanuel TV Miracle. This is Evelyn Mauli Boni and her sister Florence from Ghana. Now in this testimony they explain that Evelyn suddenly died and was declared dead for about 1 hour. Her elder sister Florence remembered that Evelyn recorded TB Joshua's prayer in her cell phone. She fetched the phone and played the message to her sister's lifeless body, and then she suddenly woke up and came back to life. Now the disturbing part about this testimony is this here. It says, explaining the 1 hour when she had been declared dead, the 16-year-old sister said when she collapsed, she saw her spirit leave her body and head for the door of the room she was in. It went into the hallway, and just when it was about to step out, it turned back to see Prophet TB Joshua standing beside her body, beckoning her to come back. This is not Christianity, this. Now let's realize what's happening here. 16-year-old Evelyn, her spirit left her body, which is the process of dying, and during that, she saw TB Joshua in spirit. This is not Christianity, this. What was TB Joshua doing there in spirit? What was he doing at Evelyn's near-death experience? This means he left his body and traveled in spirit, and he was at this location at this particular point in time. This is what is called astral projection. It is practiced widely in the occult world and by devil worshippers as well. This is not a Christian practice. People here focused on the miracle, resurrected, and they didn't catch what's going on here. Jesus said false prophets will show great signs and wonders to deceive, even if possible, the very elect. This has nothing to do with the Christian faith. This astral projection is occult practice. And then I want to show you these two testimonies here. These two women, they both tell about how TB Joshua came to their dreams to help with whatever problems they had. Let's start with this one. This woman explains that she went to bed and then she struggled with the spirit in her sleep, and then TB Joshua came up in her sleep, and then the spirit saw TB Joshua coming, and then the spirit ran away. Let's listen to that.
After my deliverance on Sunday, I went to bed on Monday. The spirit came. I was struggling with the spirit. The spirit was pressing me. As I was struggling with the spirit, I now saw our daddy in the Lord, Prophet TB Joshua, coming. So immediately the spirit now saw him. He left me and ran away.
And then this lady, she explains that TB Joshua and the wise men came to her dream. They ministered to her regarding the problem that she had. Let's just listen to that now.
So when I got the water on Sunday, the anointing water, I got back to the lodge and I said, God, I have heard several testimonies in this place. I believe you will also do the same thing for me. So I sprayed the water in my mouth. After spraying the water, I went to sleep. So when I was asleep, the man of God came to me in my sleep, Senior Prophet TB Joshua. So when I was asleep, the man of God came to me in my sleep, Senior Prophet TB Joshua. He said I should come out, that he wants to do what they've not done in this church before. I said, then I now came out. So he asked them to put a chair on the altar. So they placed the chair on the altar. He asked me to sit down. When I sat down, he called the wise men that they should lift me up to the front 7 times, the side 7 times, the left side 7 times, and they did. And when they did, he placed the sand on my head and said it was over. So the press woke me up from the sleep. So when I woke up, I ran to the toilet. A very big pool of blood fell out of my body, but because I sat on the toilet, I could not snap it.
Now, it seems here that TB Joshua has mastered this thing of intercepting other people's dreams. Yet, when Bill Subritsky asked him about this, he denied it. Are you beginning to see why TB Joshua is very controversial? Can you now see why there is so much controversy around him? Because you can't even get the truth from him. He says one thing here, and then he denies it there, and then right there, that's when the controversy and confusion starts. As we have seen in the previous segment, what TB Joshua says is not what TB Joshua does. He denied to Bill Subritsky that he appears to people in their dreams, but his followers testify that he does in fact come to their dreams. So you have his supporters divided, believing two totally different and opposite things about him. Now this is confusion, which he caused himself. This is another reason I don't believe this ministry is of God, because God is not the author of confusion. 1 Corinthians 14 verse 33. This confusion extends to another subject which is very important. If you would ask his followers who really is TB Joshua, you will not get a consensus. You will hear wild ideas. Some will tell you he is just a vessel of God, or he is just a servant of God, while others see him as more than just a church pastor or a church minister. They see him as the Messiah. They see him as Jesus. They see him as the mediator between them and Christ. These claims and views are not corrected by TB Joshua. The only thing that they correct is the healing, when they tell the people, no, Jesus is the healer. Otherwise, messianic views and claims are not corrected. Some people praise him and worship him like Jesus. Let's look into this. On the official website of TB Joshua, there's the listed blog. We click on the TB Joshua blog, and then it opens to this blog. We go to the about page, and then we get to this article. It says, the TB Joshua Fan Club is the group of individuals who love the ministry of Pastor Joshua, Pastor TB Joshua. Then they say here, we do not seek to praise the man, but praise the God who is using him in such an extraordinary way. Now this is just a front. This is just to satisfy the critics and deceive the followers and supporters to make it look like it's about God, when in reality it's all about TB Joshua. At the end of this article, there's a comment section. Yeah. Now this section is littered with comments of praise and worship towards TB Joshua. Let's look at just a few of these. Now John says, if he's not Jesus sent a second time, he cannot accomplish these great works he's doing in the name of Jesus. You are Son of God. Jesus sent you, TB Joshua, second time to finish his job. Now, John doesn't know the gospel of Jesus, because if he did, he would know that there is nothing to finish. Jesus said, it is finished. Salamatu says, if Prophet TB Joshua should die today, I don't know who God will send to help the world again. That is my worst nightmare. Now, according to Salamatu, if TB Joshua should die, then there is no hope. So the work that Jesus did doesn't mean anything to Salamatu. And then Fina says, continue to save the souls of our people. So Fina thinks TB Joshua is doing the saving of the souls. And Clementia says, the Messiah of my days. Ruth says, please forgive those that are still doubting. So Ruth thinks TB Joshua is doing the forgiving. Martin Biffles says, I always tell to people that Prophet TB Joshua is Jesus Christ, Yehoshua in spirit and person at the school. He was anointed from above, just like Jesus Christ himself. He is a complete man of God, no one, no body, either no man of God on this earth will ever do like he does. So, according to Martin Biffles, there is no one like TB Joshua. Isn't that what we say about Christ? And then down there he says, Almighty Prophet TB Joshua. So he gives the Almighty title to TB Joshua. Martin Biffles should know that God is Almighty, not a man. Eric says, indeed, this is the real Jesus Christ disguised as a black man on the African continent. These are serious blasphemies. Anna says, my life is in your hands. So Anna thinks her life is in TB Joshua's hands, not in God's hands, in TB Joshua's hands. Dimitrida says, Pastor TB Joshua, you're my mediator to Jesus Christ. Dimitrida doesn't know that the only mediator between God and man is Jesus. There is no other extra mediator in the chain. Jesus is the only mediator. Now, these are serious blasphemies. Now, this is the kind of following that TB Joshua has. This is the thinking in some of his followers.
Right from beginning, I knew I must taste condemnation in order to manage praises. Right from beginning, I knew I must taste condemnation in order to manage praises.
This saying by T.B. Joshua is very strange. But then again, it explains a lot of things. Like the video I'm about to show you next. This is a video recording a group of Sunday school children in T.B. Joshua's church singing about T.B. Joshua. It's a song of praise about T.B. Joshua. The words of the song go something like this. The synagogue church is a training ground where the Holy Spirit is flowing. Through his anointed servant, T.B. Joshua, the man of God. Everything about it is part of our lives. That's the church. Everything about him is good. That's T.B. Joshua. Now this, the Bible says, there is none righteous, no, not one. So I don't know how they got past this verse. But let's listen to that song now.
It's not God they're worshipping. It's the man in the blue suit. This is one of the prime indicators of a cult.
That was the T.B. Joshua worship song. Instead of being taught to sing unto the Lord, these kids are being taught to idolize T.B. Joshua at a very young age. This builds a cult of personality around T.B. Joshua. Now this next guy, his name is Manasseh Ibrahim. Listen to him during his testimony as he gives a short sermon about how T.B. Joshua is Jesus of our generation, much to the delight of the congregation. I want you also to notice the man in the red circle there on the left. This man, you can read his face, you can read his reaction that he agrees completely with what Manasseh is saying, proving that Manasseh is not alone in his convictions. He's not alone in his assertions. Let's listen to him.
Right now, tell us, what is your advice to people who are watching you right now and are in the same position you once found yourself?
Emmanuel, all Christians in the world, I call on them, if you have problem, I beg you in the name of Jesus, come down to synagogue where Jesus of our generation exists. T.B. Joshua is Jesus of my generation, whether you believe it or not. If you read the book of Mark, chapter 1 to the last chapter, what Jesus was doing there, anywhere he goes, he was doing good throughout his period. And that is the same thing Prophet T.B. Joshua is doing now. When Jesus was doing those things, we were not there physically to see him. But we believe him, and we read in the Bible, we believe. But today, here we are. Prophet T.B. Joshua is doing it in our present, in our eyes. We are seeing it. Why can't we believe him? Why can't we believe him? Do we want God to come down himself and tell us that this is his servant? With the miracle we have been seeing, is that not enough for us? Christians, why are we behaving so? Anyone that has problems, please, what may be your problem, whatever is your problem, come down to synagogue. Your solution is waiting for you, synagogue. Synagogue is only where...
Let's put our hands together for Jesus Christ. We know that our brother is full of emotion and he cannot wait to express what the Lord has done in his life. And finally, before we give you words of encouragement, sir, we want you to tell us, from what position were you 18 years ago and what position are you now? Tell us the post you hold now.
Okay. Manasseh said two things which stand out for me, which Jesus warned us about. Now, Manasseh said, whether we believe it or not, T.B. Joshua is Jesus of our generation. And then secondly, he said, come down to the synagogue with any problems you have. Your solution is waiting for you right there. Now, let's point out that Jesus warned us against this. Jesus said, "And if any man shall say to you, lo, here is Christ, or lo, he is there, believe him not." Again, in Matthew 24:26, it says, "Wherefore, if they shall say unto you, behold, he is in the desert, go not forth. Behold, he is in the secret chambers, believe it not." Now, Jesus says, wherever they say he is, we shouldn't go there. That would include TB Joshua's church as well. Now, interesting that Manasseh says, whether we believe it or not. And then he says, we should come down there. And Jesus actually said the opposite, in fact. So, if we love Jesus, we will keep his commandment. Because now clearly he's commanding us not to take seriously the advice of Manasseh here. He commands us not to believe Manasseh's words here. So, that means we don't listen to this guy. We stay away from scorn. We go not forth. Moving to another testimony, we find this woman. Her name is Victoria Bosede. Let's get her perspective about the man in the synagogue. Let's just listen to her now.
Through this anointing water, it was this by anointed man of God, the Messiah of our time.
She has just called TB Joshua the Messiah of our time, and the congregation clap hands. Can you now see why this church is not for a Christian? Can you now see why Jesus said we should not go forth? Because suppose you are sitting there as a Christian, and then someone says something like this. What are you going to do? Are you going to clap your hands with the rest of the church? You would be stripping Jesus of his messianic status. This is blasphemy. But then again, if you don't clap your hands, you would be the odd one out, a lost sheep. So Jesus gave us the best solution. Stay away from such places. And by the way, if you think Victoria here made a mistake, just listen further. She said it again and again. And also there, notice the man on the right in the red circle there. Just reading his face, you can tell that he agrees with what Victoria is saying, proving once again that Victoria is not the only one who is thinking this about TB Joshua. She is not alone in her convictions. Let's listen to her again from the beginning.
Through this anointing water, it was this by anointed man of God, the Messiah of our time. The Messiah of our time, the prophet of our time. I give God the glory for this prophet of our generation. I know many people out there, they don't know him, but Jesus made me as a person, as a soldier. I need him. I know the anointing in him. I know the power of God in him. That is, nobody can compare with the anointing. Is the Messiah, is the...
Hallelujah. We thank God. Our mother is so happy. Let's put our hands together for Jesus. Yes, we know you are very happy for what the Lord has done for you. We just want you, because of time, to go straight to your testimony. Tell us what the new anointing water has done in your life.
So, Victoria here and Manasseh previously, spewing serious blasphemies in TB Joshua's church and TV channel without being corrected. Instead, they are being encouraged to carry on with their testimonies. Now, this is the kind of following that TB Joshua has. As I pointed out earlier, that messianic claims about TB Joshua are not corrected. You know, they correct the part about the healing. They say, no, Jesus is the healer. I will show you this example. Listen to how this guy is corrected after he said, the anointing water will cure you. Let's listen to that correction.
Whatever problem you are having on this earth, if only you can believe and have the faith, anointing water will cure you. Praise the Lord.
Let's put our hands together for Jesus Christ. Yes, what our brother is trying to say is that Jesus Christ is the healer, and there is never a problem that he cannot solve. Remember, it is not the water that heals, delivers, or blesses, but Jesus Christ himself, since the anointing has been done in his name.
There you go. The program director stands ready to correct the errors, but they don't correct messianic claims about TB Joshua. That means they believe the same thing, and that makes TB Joshua a false messiah, because there is only one messiah, and that's Jesus, the Son of God, the Lamb of God, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Moving on to our next guy, his name is Chidi Daniel. He was a critic of TB Joshua before, so he came to TB Joshua to repent. Just listen to how he praises the man. He also asks for forgiveness, and he says something that is really shocking. So hold on to your seat for this one.
It wasn't easy for me to come. It was another mountain before me. I have to summon courage. When the center is no more at ease, I say, no, I must come. And I came on Monday. From the morning, the wise men came, and thank God, until the man in the synagogue, the man anointed, the man of the now, when he appeared, Prophet T.B. Joshua, very humble. He doesn't look like us who dress to intimidate. I saw what I have never seen among my friends, other old founders who are bishops. He hugged me. He laughed. He took picture. What a simplicity. What a humility. What a compassion. Somebody even asked him for his bag, he gave. I said, no, I've not seen this one. Inside me, something was saying, if this is the product, so if, since everything produces its kind, if we can produce these types, there will be peace in Nigeria. Man of God, I might lack word, but I know you are God in the flesh. Honestly, that's my conviction. Since I came, I've seen it in another way. I see the place as an institution, your life and your word. No man can see you on the road and believe that you're a Holy Ghost machine. I'm sorry, man of God, I have sinned against the Holy Ghost and the anointed of God. Please have mercy on me.
He has been in trouble for the past 1 week. I think he has expressed his feeling. My relationship with my Nigeria pastors, God is aware.
Chidi Daniel says he is a pastor at Grace of God Mission. I don't know what Bible he is reading, but it cannot be the Christian Bible. According to the Christian Bible, God is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. But Chidi here has just called TB Joshua God in the flesh. Now, according to Chidi Daniel, these are the options that are possible. It's either God is the Father, TB Joshua, and the Holy Ghost, or it's the Son, TB Joshua, and the Holy Ghost, or it's the Father, the Son, and TB Joshua, or it's the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost, and TB Joshua. This is nothing but satanic. Can you see how Chidi Daniel has just attacked the holy and blessed Trinity of God. Yet after a few words, he says TB Joshua is the Holy Ghost machine, and much to the delight of the congregation, as you can hear them cheering. So the blasphemy is now swept under the carpet. Now everyone is cheering. Again, I would ask, is this an environment a Christian should be in, where serious blasphemy is allowed to stand just for the exaltation of a man? Now, if TB Joshua was a true servant of God, he would have acted like Paul and Barnabas. You know, when Paul and Barnabas were called gods, they rebuked the people in the strongest terms to set the record straight. They said, which when the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard of, they rent their clothes and ran in among the people, crying out and saying, sirs, why do ye these things? We also are men of like passions with you, and preach unto you that ye should turn from these vanities unto the living God, which made the heaven and earth and the sea and all things that are therein. This would have been an appropriate response to this man. So this means TB Joshua doesn't think that Chidi is blaspheming. If TB Joshua believes you are blaspheming, he will tell you. Like in this next video, I want to show you. Just watch how TB Joshua stamps his authority there to correct what he thinks is blasphemy.
How are you? This is idol.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You are brought up from this idol home.
Yes, sir.
And it has been very strong. You have been very trying to get out of this man.
You are very correct, sir.
It's like a candle in the dark, dark community.
My father was a chief priest in my village.
He was
a chief priest of that idol. Mm-hmm. So presently left it behind for my. Though we are not born again, but it's like my head.
Look, it's a blasphemy to say born again. Without deliverance, no one can be born again.
Okay,
you
yes,
tell your neighbor, it is, please remove your mic. It is blasphemy to say I'm born again without deliverance. You know what I mean? You are taken from darkness to light. And this cannot just happen by mere talk, mere hope, mere prayer.
There you go. This proves that if TB Joshua believes you are blaspheming, he will make sure that he corrects you. Notice how he interjected here, and in a stern way, he told the usher to remove the microphone from this guy because he wants to address this so-called blasphemy. And by the way, TB Joshua is very wrong here. He says no one can be born again without deliverance. This is a false teaching. Let's remember the two thieves crucified alongside Jesus. The one simply recognized Jesus that he is indeed Lord, and this guy was a criminal, but he was repentant and he asked Jesus to remember him in his kingdom. And the guy received salvation. He was born again. He received eternal life. Jesus said to him, verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. Now Jesus performed many deliverances, and as Lord, he would know if this guy needed deliverance in order to get to paradise. But his repentant heart and belief in Christ were enough to secure salvation for this guy. So according to TB Joshua, this guy was not born again because there's no deliverance here. This is a false teaching, which makes TB Joshua a false teacher also. Can you see that he is also dangerous? He will actually make you doubt your own salvation. Let's look at one last testimony here by Maxwell Echibe. Maxwell reckons that he had a revelation from God where he saw TB Joshua seated at the right hand of the throne of God with Jesus in the middle. Let's listen to that.
The Lord bless you in Jesus' name. My name's
Bishop Maxwell Echibe. I base in Kaduna State. From Mount Zion Prophetic Ministry, Kaduna. Amen. And standing here is my lovely wife. Before I came to this ministry, actually, I was skeptical because of what they were saying about this place. And I took my time to wait on the Lord with praying and fasting. I went to mountain and said, God, if this ministry is real, reveal to me, oh God. Frankly, brothers and sisters, 2-3 days after this prayer, I was lying on my bed, and at night, I had a revelation. I saw the throne of God, and I saw Jesus seated in the middle. And surrounding him were ministers of God, and they were white men. But I saw one black man sitting by the right-hand side. And I went close to look at his face, the black man's face. Lo and behold, it was the face of Senior Prophet T.B. Joshua. Amen. People of God, please let us stand up and give Jesus 3 hallelujah shout. 1, 2, go. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. In that dream, I saw Jesus seated on the throne. It was like an altar like this. He was seated in the middle. And by the right, we are ministers of God. But in that revelation, they were all white men. And I saw only one black man seated by the right-hand side. And I went close to say, where is this white black man? Lo and behold, brothers and sisters, the Lord bear me witness, it was prophet, Senior Prophet T.B. Joshua. I now said, Jesus, who is this? And Jesus spoke to me, that's my son. And I said, Jesus, what of other great men of God? We hear their names. Jesus said to me, they are here, but they are in the overflow. They are not qualified to come to this altar. Amen. In that fear gripped me. I woke up and I said, truly, I don't want to hear what anybody says anymore. I will go to Prophet T.B. Joshua.
Now, testing Maxwell's revelation according to the Word of God. If we follow the example of the Bereans in Acts 17:11 by searching the scriptures, you will see that Maxwell's revelation violates the scripture. According to the scripture, it is Jesus who is at the right hand of the throne of God. Let's look at the verses. Acts 7:55, Jesus standing on the right hand of God. Acts 7:56, and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God. Psalms 110:1, the Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou on my right hand. Hebrews 1:3, set down on the right hand of the majesty on high. Hebrews 8:1, who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens? Romans 8:34, who is even at the right hand of God? Acts 2:33, therefore being by the right hand of God exalted. Acts 2:34, the Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou on my right hand. Luke 20:42, the Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou on my right hand. Hebrews 10:12, set down on the right hand of God. Hebrews 12:2, set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Mark 16:19, set on the right hand of God. Colossians 3:1, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Ephesians 1:20, set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places. 1 Peter 3:22, and is on the right hand of God. It is clear that Maxwell's revelation is a heresy and it's unscriptural. It completely rearranged and reshuffled the throne of God to accommodate TB Joshua. It puts TB Joshua in Christ's place and the Father is removed. This is an attack on the throne of God. How can this not be satanic? The congregation is blessed by all this. This is further proof that this environment is not for a Christian. This revelation follows the same pattern as the testimonies we have seen. TB Joshua is Jesus of our generation. TB Joshua is the Messiah of our time. TB Joshua is God in the flesh. TB Joshua is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. This puts TB Joshua in Christ's place, which makes TB Joshua a false Christ and a false prophet. He is indeed another fulfillment of Matthew 24, verse 24. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Everything was good. Everything was perfect. Until man disobeyed God's word. For the first time, man walked not according to God's instruction. This was the fall of man. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. So from there, sin has greatly multiplied upon the face of the earth. All kinds of sin have flooded the world since the time of the fall. There are too many sins in the world, I can't even list all of them here. All of us have committed at least one of these sins here. Now the scripture says we all have sinned. So now this is a problem because God hates sin. It is clear there. That they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. It is clear that they who do these things shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. This is the reality of sin. This is the ultimate price of sin. This is the reward for sin. But you see, God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. You know, there is no greater prophet than John the Baptist, and John did no miracle. Now, isn't this amazing? We would probably measure greatness by number and the greatness of miracles that a prophet does, but the Lord doesn't see it like that. He says John, who didn't do any miracles, was the greatest prophet. Now, John was very humble. He preached a simple message. He preached, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand." When Jesus began to preach, he said, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand." And just before he ascended to heaven, he charged his disciples, saying that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations. The apostles preached repentance as well. Apostle Peter said, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins." Now here 3,000 people were saved. He says again, "Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out." The apostle Paul also preached repentance. He says, "And the times of ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent." Paul said he should first unto them of Damascus and at Jerusalem and throughout all the coast of Judea, and then to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God and do the works meet for repentance. Now, you might say that, "Yeah, but repentance is for those in the world, you know, it's not for the Christians, it's not for the church." Well, try and tell that to the churches in Asia in Revelation 2 and 3. The church in Pergamos were commended for holding fast the name of the Lord and holding on to the faith in Jesus. But Jesus rebuked this church for tolerating the doctrine of Balaam and the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. Jesus told this church to repent. The church in Ephesus, they were commended for having patience and having worked hard for the name of the Lord and for not tolerating evil and taking tough stance against false apostles. But the Lord told them to repent and do the first works. But he still commended them for hating the deeds of the Nicolaitans. The church in Sardis were told to repent. The church in Laodicea were told, "As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous therefore and repent." So repentance is a serious matter. When we repent, we turn away from our sins and turn to God. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Think of it this way. Suppose your kids are playing in the mud. There is no way you will allow them to come into the house and sit in the lounge and sit at dinner and go to bed like that. No, they must get out of there first and then wash up. The principle is the same. We must leave our sinful lifestyle behind and come to God, and He will cleanse us. But you see, in God's system, it is the blood that washes the sins. It is the blood that maketh an atonement for the soul. Without shedding of blood is no remission. As the scripture says, "For it is not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sin." You ask, then why was the Old Testament established? Well, we need to understand that the Old Testament was like a drawing. Think of it this way. If I gave you a drawing of a house, the drawing would have lots of detail telling and showing how the house must look like. It would have several sketches. You know, it would show you here, it shows you the back and the front, and then it shows the two sides here, and then this is the aerial view of the rooms inside the house, and then this is another sketch that shows the whole area of the house. Now the model of it would look something like this. But when the house is fully built, it's going to be one structure. It's not going to be six structures showing each one. No. It's going to be one structure that fulfills all of these sketches here. So I tell you, it is not possible for me and my family to take shelter in this model here. So the principle is the same with the Old Testament and the Gospel of Christ. It was necessary to have the Old Testament first so that when the Messiah comes, he can be identified. Now imagine if we didn't have the Old Testament prophecies, then anyone can come in and claim to be the Messiah and we wouldn't know for sure. But with the Old Testament scriptures, we know that the Messiah must fulfill what is written in there. And that's how they identified him. I mean, Philip findeth Nathanael and said unto him, "We have found him, of whom Moses in the law and the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." And Jesus further confirmed this when he said later that, "Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill." Now, some of our friends in the Seventh-day Adventists, they think that this verse is talking about the Ten Commandments. No, it can't be talking about the Ten Commandments. It's talking about the entire Old Testament. I mean, you can see here also that Jesus says, "The prophets, for all the prophets and the law prophesied until John." So here you have the law prophesying. So it cannot only be the Ten Commandments. It's the whole law of Moses. The law and the prophets is the Old Testament, the first five books of Moses and the other prophets as well. And then Jesus further confirmed that what is written in there was about him. He says, "These are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms concerning me." So Jesus is the Lamb of God which taketh away the sin of the world. We don't come to Jesus because we want earthly riches. No, this is not the gospel. We come to Jesus because we need our sins to be forgiven and be saved from eternal damnation. His blood cleanseth us. Jesus says about his blood, "For this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins." The apostles also taught about the blood of Christ. It says here, "Being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him." It says, "In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins." In whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. The blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sin. Unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. So it was necessary to shed the blood. But only clean, sinless, and perfect blood could truly wash away sin. But there is no clean, sinless, and perfect blood on earth, because all have sinned. Only God is clean, sinless, and perfect. But God is a spirit. So that is why he became flesh, so that he can be the lamb to provide the clean, sinless, and perfect blood. So Jesus came, he died on the cross, and rose the third day. He went up to heaven and sat at the right hand of the Father. So let's look unto Jesus, who is the author and finisher of our faith. Let us call on him who is revealed in the scriptures. He is Alpha and Omega, the resurrection and the life, the way, the truth and the life, the light of the world, the bread of life, the Messiah, the Christ, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Lamb of God, the bright and morning star, the Son of the living God. Let's call on him and be saved. Amen.